So our next speaker is from Victoria. Sport and Rec Victoria, and has a background in the sports industry, as opposed to being an engineer. So Philip has worked in the sports sector for 15 years in various roles that you all recognise: sport development, event coordination, leisure services, recreation planning, grant making, program management, you name it, he's done it in the sports sector. He's currently the group manager at Sport and Rec Victoria, and is responsible for their investment. Now, poor New Zealanders are going to be very jealous about the kind of dollar figures that these both speakers throw around. Philip is responsible for overseeing $93 million worth of investment, which you're going to find out through this presentation, I think, a lot about partnering, because he turns that into $500 million worth of projects. So there's going to be some really interesting stuff in Philip's presentation. He works really closely with local government, with state sports associations, with community organisations, so we might be getting down to some of the smaller community issues. I know some of you are here from those kind of communities. Interestingly, Victoria has a similar population to New Zealand, so about 4 million, and, we found out last night, a very similar number of councils, local government, so 70-plus councils in Victoria. So I think some of those brick wall issues will come up again in this presentation too. So Philip's married with three young boys. He hasn't told me about what sports he plays, because it says down here he does his best to get out and enjoy.
Yeah, it doesn't mean I'm any good.
No, so there's quite a lot of us who struggle to get out doing it. We work in the sector, and then getting out in it is a bit of a challenge. But anyway, Philip holds a Master in Sport Management, a Bachelor of Arts degrees from Deakin University, and a Diploma of Project Management from the Australian Institute of Management. So I think the contrasting style you're going to see now will be another lot of food for thought for us to help us learn and grow in what we can do here. So thank you, Philip.
Thanks, Sarah. Thank you for welcoming me so warmly to New Zealand. Thank you to Richard and to Sport New Zealand for having me and for having Charles here too. I'm learning as much from Charles as I am from others I've met, so that's terrific. And last night I had the pleasure of spending some time with senior staff at Sport New Zealand and with the CEO, Peter, in particular. And I'm really impressed with the quality of leadership you have here in New Zealand. And I think you're in really good hands. And we've seen with the focus here in high performance how that's paid off at Olympic level with All Blacks and Silver Ferns and a range of other teams performing really well on the world stage. And for the population that you have and the market you have to draw upon, you're succeeding well above the medal count and the success that Australia has in world competition. So you should be very proud of yourselves on that point. I wanted to make some observations before I began my presentation of New Zealand and how I might see New Zealand from an Australian context. I see New Zealand as a very humble country. You have a very strong history of innovation and human rights, the treaty of Waitangi and the celebrations you have every year, giving women the vote, if my memory serves me right, about 1893 or 1853 or very early, well before the rest of the world, and that's real testament to how progressive this society is. And despite the fact that we claim a lot of our musicians and actors and celebrities to be our own, the more you delve into it, the more we learn that they're actually from here. So we need to stop doing that and give you some more credit. The All Blacks is an interesting parallel. I just mentioned them in terms of high performance. But when you think about the parallel with the All Blacks having a very strong culture, a very strong organisation, translating to very strong on-field performance and successive years of high-quality on-field performance, I think when Sport New Zealand starts to delve more into facilities, I think we're going to see years of success when it comes to participation gains and health outcomes for this country. And the work that Richard's doing is absolutely superb, and I commend him on it and encourage all of you to get behind the work that will eventually come to the fore once the organisation determines what path it wants to travel forward. So well done. All right, let's kick it off. As Sarah said, a different presentation, a broad brush approach today. I'm going to delve into a few things and try and cover as many topics as I can. So we at Sport and Recreation Victoria have five very simple roles. We support the sector. and that is the sports sector as well as the peak industry bodies that exist in Victoria. We develop major events and facilities, so you'll all know about the major tennis open we have in January. Well, the facilities built for that were solely funded by the Victorian government. We support and develop and help plan and assist in guiding the development of community facilities as well. We do our best to improve participation. We do a whole range of things. We provide small grants to clubs to subsidise the cost of uniforms and decrease the cost of participation, all the way through to having a whole month where the Premier is encouraging the whole state to become physically active for 30 minutes a day. And we also do a lot of policy and research. We have a strong history of that. And some of the outcomes and the programmatic responses we've developed are a result of the research that I'll touch on today. In terms of community facilities, we fund local government exclusively. On very few occasions will we not fund a council, and there needs to be a very good reason for us to do that. And we take a low-risk approach to doing that. We know that councils aren't going anywhere. On the whole, they're very financial. They have the expertise to run and manage projects and be financially accountable to the state government. So we choose local government as our main key partner. Range of facilities, indoor and outdoor aquatic facilities, indoor sports stadiums like this one. This one is very impressive, I must say. Sports fields, outdoor sports courts and pavilions, synthetic surfaces, floodlights, skate parks, playgrounds, trails, the list goes on. We're really only limited to the participation outcomes we can see from projects that are proposed. If we see a project that is not a project we've seen before, but we know it's going to have fantastic participation outcomes, we'll seriously consider it. So we're not limiting ourselves to a list of specific projects that we might look at. We have a very strong focus on planning in Victoria. And we see planning as a real important key step in determining where people might go to develop those facilities and how they develop those facilities. So between 2000 and 2006, I should point up here, and 2010, we funded 140 planning projects. Everything from recreation strategies focused on recreation programming to feasibility studies to master plans to council studies as well. We start to drop off quite a bit. We get down to pavilions over here at about 102, 103. Lighting projects are very popular. Sports courts, so we're talking about netball courts, multi-use tennis courts, mostly outdoor, and the list goes on. And as you get down to these areas here, you're talking about, you know, lower use, lower participation inducing facilities, such as training facilities and grandstands. Our funding sources are varied. Everyone that I've met has talked about lotto and lottery, and you know, it's the same in England. There's a lot of lottery reliance as well, and that's fine. And I think we have an emerging issue in Victoria and in Australia in particular around sports betting. It has really exploded in the last 5 years, particularly with online access. And I think I'd like to see governments in Australia try and tackle how we can maximise the community value out of the legalised sports betting that happens in Australia. So national and state facilities are funded from the core appropriation or the state budget, but we have what's called the Community Support Fund. So if you've been to Melbourne, you would have heard and seen of Crown Casino. We have a structure where sporting clubs and some private organisations own poker machines right around the state, and everything outside of Crown Casino has a pokies tax. So 8% of what goes into the machine is taxed, goes to the state government, is used for various programs, but the Community Support Fund holds about $100 million per year and distributes that money to various community programs and initiatives. And we're lucky enough to secure some of that money. And we fund our flagship program, the Community Facility Funding Program, which is about $20 million a year out of that fund. We also have two smaller programs. The first one is the Country Football and Netball Program. That in 2006, the government undertook an inquiry into the viability of small towns and the future of small towns, and discovered that country football and netball clubs, who are joined clubs in Victoria, were really central to the social, health and emotional fabric of those towns. So since that time, we've been funding football and netball clubs in country locations to improve their facilities. Our small-scale facility program is our undertaking for the government to deliver their election commitments. And there's 85 projects in that list, and there's about $14 million that we're supporting and delivering as governments wish to do. So just delving into our program, we provide maximum grant amounts for different types of projects. We recognise the cost and the impact that aquatic centres can have, and so we provide the maximum grant amount of $3 million to those. We provide $200,000 also to seasonal pools. So we have an enormous number of outdoor 50 metre and 33 metre pools that were built following the Second World War that are memorial pools. And we can't close them, we can't knock them down and rebuild them and move them, but we have to find a way to rejuvenate them and keep them operating because that's the wish of the community. So we provide some real core funding to do things like solar panels, blankets to save water evaporation, upgrade of change rooms, upgrade of amenities and access from car parks, some real basic stuff to keep these things going. 650 we provide to major facilities, so that's new recreation reserves in growth areas, or it might be new stadiums like this one. We acknowledge that 650 to a $30 million indoor stadium is probably not the level that we should be looking at these facilities at, and we're working hard to address that. And you just look around here and you see how many uses you can get out of this building, and you realise that the impact is quite massive, and we need to be looking at that. $100,000 for minor facilities. So minor facilities are floodlighting, netball courts, tennis courts, skate parks, playgrounds, and in some locations, particularly in the country, that buys you a lot. In metropolitan locations, where companies tend to, as Charles said, utilise the advantage, I guess, of dealing with government, will provide a bit less value to those sort of outcomes. We've got a real focus on soccer. In the last 4 or 5 years, soccer has grown exponentially in Victoria. New South Wales still leads the country in soccer participation, but we realised that soccer growth went through the roof, particularly girls, women and juniors, and that we didn't have enough change rooms or a stock of change rooms to cater for everybody. And what we don't want is a situation where a pavilion has two change rooms, the boys' team's using the change rooms, the girls' team is changing behind the pavilion or in vehicles because they can't get access to the pavilion. That's just an inexcusable situation, so we're working hard to address that. And we provide up to $50,000 for planning. So planning is the smallest category, that's why we're able to provide the most number of grants. We provide up to $50,000 for regional planning projects. So if a number of local authorities get together and they say they want to address an issue around trails that cross borders or basketball stadiums or soccer facilities, we'll reward them by giving them a bit more than our usual grant, which is $30,000. And we think that's a really good incentive for doing some coordinated regional planning. It also means we're dealing with economies of scale and able to have a bigger influence. This program has been running in various forms since 1972, so there's a long, long history of funding facilities, and there's an expectation that it'll exist in the future and that the levels will be maintained. And we fund about 130 projects per year, and that funding has to be matched. And the reason is that we feel that is the best way to get buy-in from the local community and from the local council. If we don't get buy-in via the matched funding, then the decisions are down to us and we may be delivering those projects and taking the risk of those. But we feel that when communities can fundraise and input into projects, they have the ownership. They're going to be left with it at the end of the day, they're going to manage it, maintain and operate it, and it's in their interest to be really involved from the outset. So our funding, as Sarah mentioned, since 2000 we've funded over 3,500 projects, which is almost $400 million over that time. And we're able to leverage $2.50 for every dollar we put in. So the ratios in metropolitan Melbourne, for example, are 1 to 3. We'll put in a dollar for every $3 locally. So we're funding about 25% of those projects. In country Victoria, we're funding 1 to 1. So we can provide really good value and match the funding raised locally. This is a list of the project requirements that we seek. We don't have a policy that says this is what we'll fund in terms of sports facilities. We utilise the guidelines of our flagship program to set the tone and to set the policy by which we'll fund these projects. So these are all the things that we'll assess as part of a application and assessment process to ensure that the proponents and the schemes that are being put forward meet the mark. We have an oversubscription as they do in England, and we have a real key focus on ensuring we're funding the right projects. This graph gives us confidence that we're doing the right thing. So 100% of projects over here increased sport and recreation participation. And we know that's the biggest thing we want to do, because that's where the biggest health and benefits are. And we collect this information by doing what's called an outcomes report. 12 months after the projects are finished, we'll go back to the project partners and ask them what the outcomes were. There's no point doing that when the doors open on the first day, because the place hasn't operated just yet. Other focus of ours that we're seeing demonstrated here are improved energy and water efficiency. The cost of utilities in Victoria skyrocketed. We have a diesel plant that's sitting there that's costing us a fortune that we're not using because the drought broke, but we'll need it in case there's another drought. And so we're all paying for that water storage. Gas and electricity have similarly risen exponentially during that time as well. So it's in our interest to create really efficient buildings that cost operators less to run. We've been able to increase the revenue and the viability of these facilities as well, which is a really key thing. So increased and improved secondary spend. More people through the door means better business. So the participation and the viability go hand in hand. And a range of other benefits as well, which you can see on the screen there. We have a set of priorities. Some of these priorities are set by the organisation, but many of them are also set by government, depending on their policy platform. So women and girls are a key platform of the current government, and we're addressing that by making change rooms a priority, by making netball a priority, but we're also seeing an increase in girls wanting to play Australian rules football and cricket and soccer and rugby and the non-traditional female sports. So when we have applications open, we're seeing a lot of proponents say we want two extra change rooms to cater for girls as well. And in fact, we're going a step further. So what you'll see in a traditional change room or pavilion style building is open showers and urinals. And that just doesn't suit the modern expectations that customers and consumers have. What we're making sure that we put in every pavilion now is we're ensuring that the cubicles exist in showers and there are cubicles existing for toilets. Now some of the blokes, particularly the ones out in the country, say, we don't need that, we're still going behind the tree. You know, we don't need to formalise all this sort of refurbishment of facilities, but the reality is that expectations have changed and privacy is now an important part of our social life. And everyone deserves the privacy of being able to shower and go to the toilet without people watching them. That's a basic human need, I think. And so we're following that through with funding. We've got a real focus on growth areas. Melbourne is growing really quickly, and Melbourne will surpass Sydney in population in the next 30 years. And rather than having satellite cities or two or three major cities like you have in New Zealand, we have Melbourne. We have regional cities, but Melbourne is growing and growing out. It's probably 120, 130 kilometres wide east to west now. So growth is a key priority for us, as is disadvantaged communities, as is addressing safety and standards of facilities. A lot of facilities we've seen, particularly netball courts, were built with a smaller runoff next to light poles or next to fences. We're addressing that issue by ensuring that courts are now compliant. We focus on disasters as well and make sure we're part of the recovery effort. Universal design, which I'll touch on in a few moments, and also environmental sustainable design. Every one of our projects that we fund must consider universal design and ESD. And in fact, for our bigger projects, 20% of our grant must be spent on over and above ESD elements. So not just natural lighting or ventilation or recycled materials, things that are innovative, things that are going to push the boundaries and be a little bit experimental, but also some that are proven. We work really hard to provide planning advice. And I think there's a key lesson here for Sport New Zealand in that we can't be everywhere and we can't speak to all 79 councils and the recreation staff and some of the 16,000 clubs that exist in the state. But we can produce materials that everyone can read and everyone can access. So planning guides has become a really efficient way of doing that. And we've been doing that for a long period of time, but in more recent years we've provided advice on lighting. Lighting is a big issue, particularly if you want competition standard lighting. Artificial grass for sport. Tennis facility planning guide, which has now been adopted nationally by Tennis Australia. Netball court planning guide. The good play space guide, which is a response to the lack of quality when it comes to play spaces. And I must say, one of my observations is that I haven't seen too many play spaces, or maybe I haven't seen enough play spaces in the right places around the places that I've seen so far. Similarly, in Melbourne, there's a playground in every little green space around the city and in towns. And that introduction to physical activity for young children is a really key step in getting them to develop their motor skills, their sensory skills, and stepping up through their life as they venture into sport and having the confidence to do that. We've done some work around aquatics, concourses and catchments for aquatic facilities. And in the next few months, we're going to release some work on universal design, which will be world leading, and we'd love to share with you as well. And environmental sustainable design as well. We're also keen not just to provide broad planning advice, but also technical advice to these projects. So what I've grabbed is three pages out of our lighting guide. So this shows, and you're not meant to be able to read this, so don't worry about it too much. It's available on our website. This shows the detail that we provide to organisations, clubs and associations about how much planning they need to do before they come to us. So this is a lighting plan with lux levels, of course, and the design summary is based here. So if you're looking at a 200 lux project, that's what the guidelines tell you, that's what should come to us as an application. And this will be the basis by which we fund projects of this standard. We also provide guidance on the likely cost of each component of a lighting project, from cabling, wiring, installation, replacement of globes, and the lifetime of those globes. So that's really key to knowing if we are over-investing or a club is over-capitalising in a lighting project and trying to get some more out of the government than they need to. And here are the outline of the different standards for each of the sports that we might be supporting. So that technical advice, it costs us a bit of money to develop, so we might have spent $50,000 or $60,000 developing that. But the time and effort and the money it in turn saves us in being able to do other things with our time, be more strategic and more planning, is really critical to doing business. Some standout facilities very quickly. Aquination is in a suburb called Ringwood. It's under construction at the moment, which is why I've got some architectural representations here. The beauty of this facility, and there's been some discussion, particularly in Christchurch, about how we meld elite participation and community participation, or high performance and community. And here's an example where it's going to happen really well, we anticipate. So this is focused around aquatic sports. There is a 66-metre pool going into this facility with two booms. And the booms will be able to split the 50 from the diving pool and the synchro pool and the water canoe polo area to the 50 metre pool, and in fact you can divide the 50 metre pool again. So what we know is when you've got a boom in a 50, most of the time it's a 25 metre pool or two 25 metre pools. So we're putting an extra boom to make sure we get the flexibility we need to be able to run programs, aqua aerobics, lap swimming, and be able to maintain some diving programming during the day. And the only difference that I mentioned this the other day, the only difference between a 50 metre pool and a 25 metre pool is one tumble turn. And we've got to start telling communities that communities that want a 50 metre pool, the only difference is one tumble turn. And you can still swim the same distance. We've been able to incorporate a dry diving centre here and a full FINA compliant diving facility and other amenities. Not that this facility wants to host the World Championships or the World Titles, but this facility wants to be able to host the best national competition it can host. And they've made a decision very early on in their business planning that they're willing to upscale the project, and the federal government's invested in that outcome, to be able to provide an opportunity for Diving Victoria or Diving Australia to run activities here. And this area has been chosen because it's central to diving success. So many of our national divers and Olympic divers come out of this facility. or the previous facility that was at this site. $48 million build, and Charles will cringe at how much that's costing. But it's dollars, not pounds. So, and all governments are investing as well. So that's not an unusual price for this scale facility. And what we've seen in the last 3-4 years with the small R recession that's happened in Australia is that building costs have come down 15 to 20%. So we can afford much more building than we could have 5 years ago. So we'll take advantage of that. The second one I wanted to show you is a project that I manage directly and fortunate enough to be involved with, is the State Basketball Centre. State Basketball Centre has been built out of Melbourne. It's 25 kilometres from Melbourne on the EastLink freeway, some might be familiar with it, that connects the city, the airport, to Frankston and the peninsula. And the EastLink corridor is a key corridor for us because when we did some research into basketball participation, we realised that 40% of participation in Australia comes from that eastern corridor. So from Collingwood following EastLink down to Frankston, 40%. So to not have the State Basketball Centre here wouldn't have made sense. So Basketball Victoria moved out of MSAC, which is the city in Albert Park in Melbourne, and relocated here. And the site is big enough to accommodate 14 courts eventually. What we've built at the moment is 2 halls of 3 courts with a 3,200-seat show court here that is convertible back into 3 community courts, and a central spine of amenities, and also an administration and foyer block here. So that has 35 Basketball Victoria staff, the association's in there as well, and they're growing, but we've also got room for an NBL team. So it's been mooted for some time that that New Zealand might have an extra team down the track, maybe based out here at Wellington, and a second team out in Melbourne, and a second team will actually play out of here. So we have to make sure in the planning that we future-proof this facility from an elite point of view and from a community point of view. A couple of slides on what's happening in participation and how you might start to think about some of the interventions and some of the strategies to address lower participation levels. It is very easy and very, I guess the easy way out, I should say, to keep growing the strong participation numbers. But the challenge and what we have to do as a sector is to grow the parts of our industry that are suffering and where participation has the potential to increase. So the CSIRO, which is our science organisation, research organisation, came up with 6 megatrends of Australian sport. And some of these will be familiar to you and will apply to you and also to Charles in England. We're seeing a stronger individualisation of sport, so more individual activities as opposed to team activities. We're seeing more adventure and alternative sports as well. Some of the stuff you see at X Games or you see on YouTube of people doing crazy things is just becoming the norm now, and people my age look at them and think they're crazy. Governments are now acknowledging the broader benefits of sport, that it's not just about being healthy, but it's about social connection, it's about economic output, it's about jobs, it's about the management jobs that occur in a facility like this. And when you think about an aquatic center and how that operates, in some ways it's similar to a McDonald's, that the large proportion of the staff that work there are a younger staff. They're people that are studying and training and who want lifelong employment in our sector. So they provide real significant opportunities to young people as well. We have an ageing population. We have an opportunity to seek economic growth out of Asia as well. And we see, you know, an example with a lot of our footballers and soccer players going to Asia as an opportunity to earn a good income. And market pressures to corporatise sport as well. So the Big Bash League that's been established is a way to corporatise cricket and to provide Australian cricket with a sustainable form of income based solely on TV rights. So despite the popularity of the internet and their various other forms of technology, TV is still a massive winner for sport. And it's single-handedly made cricket sustainable again in Australia. We know that facilities are a real key to increasing participation, but in terms of percentage, it's not 100% of the impact. It's a percentage, but not that high. The other influences are a few. The cost of participation is an influence, and there was a question about cost earlier. Residential use of land and how estates are planned as well has an impact. Demographics has an impact. Access to transport and getting around neighbourhoods has an impact, as does the attractiveness of facilities and the information provided and what we think of our own health status. So if we're overestimating how healthy we are, we're less likely to exercise. But if we take a more humble approach, a more realistic approach to how healthy we are, we're more inclined to participate. This is a case study to emphasise, despite those factors, how important facilities are. Is that in Maribyrnong City Council in 2007, they were ranked 25 out of 31 metropolitan councils for participation. Only 5 years later, they were ranking 14. And the only thing, when we looked into it, that changed during that time was the development of significant scale facilities in the right locations. So they had a new major aquatic centre with a 50 metre pool. It was located in the centre of Maribyrnong next to a major shopping centre. So you could walk from the shop straight into the pool and vice versa. We had a four-court stadium built at Witten Oval, the home of the Western Bulldogs, which was right next door to a urban renewal project where 3,000 people will move in the coming years. So that provides a real catalyst to get some participation in there. We've got a new Maribyrnong Sports College focused on sports education. Four basketball courts, six badminton courts, used during the day and after hours. That's had double the impact of participation in that area. And as I mentioned, the co-location and the opportunity to put those facilities next to urban renewal increases the opportunity for creating successful facilities. And there's a key lesson in there for people working in Christchurch. Just a quick note on Melbourne's growth. The green bit, so that's Melbourne Centre. That's out west towards Adelaide. That's down the coast towards Phillip Island. Many of you will be familiar with that. The dark green bits are the growing areas. So we have significant pressure to fund facilities. And the money we give is actually not enough at the moment. So we're relying on developer contributions and ratepayers to fund the development of these things. So in Wyndham, which is over here, Wyndham is between Melbourne and Geelong, they're undertaking simultaneously a $48 million 12-court indoor stadium and a $40 million redevelopment of their pool. And they're borrowing the majority of that money. So they know the importance of providing physical activity for their community, and they're willing to borrow a huge amount of money to do it and bank on residents moving in to be able to fund those borrowings. So the lesson out of that is that we can have reinforced to us from this graph that in areas of growth, so population growth, where you can never actually keep up with enough facilities in the early stages of development, participation is a lot lower. So that's the west and the outer west, and that's the southeast. So as a government, we need to take advantage of this information and think about how we might provide extra support to growth areas. Does metropolitan Melbourne need so much money, or as much money as other municipalities? Maybe we need to be redirecting our support to areas that have a lower participation rate. We also know that disadvantage plays a role. So the higher the income, the higher the participation. That's pretty logical. But what do we do as a government to intervene? We need to provide better quality facilities in a more timely fashion in disadvantaged communities and make sure they're matched up with programs that support people and encourage people to come out and participate at low cost. There's no point in putting a fitness first out there and charging $100 a month to participate in those locations. It doesn't make business sense. But it does make sense to provide multi-purpose, multi-line marked free public tennis courts, which we've done, which are wildly popular. And we think that's a great way to provide an introduction to sport as well. An ageing population, not that over 40 is aged, but the older you get, the less likely you are to participate. And so we need to be really careful about how we support bowling clubs. We need to make sure that when we're funding cricket, soccer, football, the traditional sports, that those clubs are working on masters and veterans teams. And they're making sure that some of those older players are also helping volunteer and coach in those clubs. And we want the sports to be able to capture the older market as well. So COTA, which is Council of the Ageing, have done a lot of work around how clubs might capture an older market and keep them involved and entertained, if you like. And this is the blue bars are the ageing tsunami happening in Victoria. So the blue bars represent the growth in over 65s. It's staggering, isn't it? And so, you know, this points to the fact that we can deliver facilities, no problem. They can be funded, they can be built, they can be operated. But what are we doing as a sector to program those facilities and make them accessible for older communities? Are we reaching out to residential retirement homes? Are we reaching out to bowling clubs to give those bowlers another opportunity to participate in something different? Are we providing gym programs for older adults to develop their strength? So the programming really needs to match the facility outcomes. We know where there's a stronger multicultural community that participation is lower as well. And we have in Melbourne and Victoria, you know, pockets of higher multicultural communities. And you can see that in the participation data across municipalities that the participation is quite low. So should we be focused on providing the standard Australian rules and cricket participation? I don't think we should. I think we should be asking those communities what they played in their home country that we could help provide here. And we shouldn't be afraid to introduce new sports and activities that communities will be comfortable in playing and recreating. We have a real issue around female participation, as I mentioned, and we're doing some things to address that. So in the early years, when there are huge health benefits and lifelong habits being developed, females are participating much less than men. So the challenge to us as a sector and to you as a sector is to do something about it, is to work with sport to develop female programs. And some of the bigger sports are doing it really well, and some of the smaller sports are just doing business as usual. Cycling, jogging, running, swimming and diving, the most popular activities. They're free, you can do them almost anywhere, and almost any ability can participate in those activities. So we're really focused on when we have $20 million to spend, that we're not spending it strictly on sport, that we're spending it on trails and lighting cycling paths so people can cycle into the night. We're making sure there's good signage and access off the main principal bicycle network. We're ensuring that that BMX is provided locally so that 10-year-olds and 9-year-olds don't have to travel to the next community to access that activity. Something you should be very proud of, our stats research officer at SRV is a Kiwi, and he threw all this stuff at me, including how do I interpret the New Zealand accent, which I found amusing. You know, I need to stay here a while to work that out. But this light blue line all along here is Victoria, and everything else is New Zealand. So you do way better than us in walking, swimming, cycling, fishing, jogging, dance, golf, bushwalking, and even just driving from the airport to the hotel. People everywhere. It was freezing yesterday. There's a lot of wind. People running, cycling, walking, people out and about enjoying the countryside. So I've come from 40 degree heat, so it wasn't that warm yesterday. And so what I think you need to do as a sector, if you don't know the answers right now, is what's led to this? What are the reasons for your success and how can you build upon it? And how can we grow these sports down here or these activities to become a bit higher? Because you clearly have success stories here that we'd love to learn from, and maybe Charles would love to learn from. And that's something you should be very proud of. We've got some great facility challenges, and I think some of these will be similar to yours. The cost of infrastructure, which Charles has talked about, some strategies about reducing that. We have a lot of old pools built out of the Second World War, and those older pools are now 50, 60, 70 years old, and they're concrete shells, and concrete doesn't last forever. So we're working with councils to try and address that issue and maintain those facilities. We have challenges, as you would, about investing in metropolitan locations versus towns versus regional centres, and what's the balance here? If a council like Melbourne City Council is very financial, do we need to actually offer them any grants? Should we provide those to vulnerable locations? School facilities are a huge problem for us. In terms of participation, only 9% of people who participate in sport and rec used a school facility. It's tragic, it really is, it's a shocker. And so that wasn't helped by the fact that during the building education revolution, run under the previous Labor government, that they funded three-quarter size courts again. So the Victorian government does that, the education department does that, and then we've done the same all over again. And the cookie cutter approach hasn't worked. So there's a court near where I live. It is big enough in terms of height and width to have a basketball game, but the court is not long enough. And so the clubs who are seeking indoor space, and it might not be for basketball, can't use that facility. So we're undoing all the things that we know about, and we know enough now to act on those sort of issues. But education more broadly, and maybe it's the same here, is just not thinking about the community often enough and thinking about the broader implications. And in some cases, we're happy to pay for the extra space. And we've recently funded a three-quarter size court at a high school that's being built to become three full-size netball courts, and that's a great outcome, but we shouldn't have to pay for it in all those circumstances. Synthetic replacements. During the drought, we had a huge uptake in synthetic surfaces from everywhere from primary schools to soccer pitches. And we've tried to ensure that every project that we've funded has a capital replacement plan, the clubs have a sinking fund, and then there's appropriate income along the 10 to 12 years of that facility to reinvest in the upgrade, because we strictly won't invest in the renewal of that project. But I suspect that many of the primary schools that have these facilities are going to have a financial noose around that neck. And as they get to year 8, 9, 10 and 11, I think they're going to come back to government and say, we're in a bit of strife here. We can't find the $200,000 we need to replace it. And $200,000 for a primary school is a lot of money. And traditional programming. We know now that traditional programming is not working. It does work for a percentage of the population, but people are seeking something different. And what we've done quite successfully in Melbourne is install a lot of competition standard lighting at cricket grounds, football grounds, soccer facilities and rugby facilities. And what that does, in fact, is it moves or creates the potential to move Saturday and Sunday daytime fixtures to Friday night fixtures and to Wednesday evening fixtures, where you don't have a lot of load on those grounds and you can move some of the training and provide another outlet for kids. And we know that Saturday is probably the busiest day of the week. There's shopping, there's language school, there's appointments, there's paying the bills, there's fixing the house and mowing the lawn. And providing non-traditional programming is a way to really address the lifestyle, the busy lifestyle that we all have at the moment. In terms of cost of facilities, we've also learnt that between 1999 and 2009 in Victoria, the cost of facilities grew by 40%. So that has a huge impact on the scope and scale of what you can build. It also obviously has an impact on what local government can afford to do. And instead of building three pavilions per year or building three new facilities, they're building one or two. And that has an impact on participation. So some of the strategies that Charles has outlined have a real validity, and you should encourage you to look into those as well and see how they apply to your setting. But one of the focuses that we look at those things is how you can improve your business, how can you improve your customer base, what's the product offering, what's the marketing campaign, how will you put information out there. Setting up a Facebook account and setting up a Twitter account ain't going to do it, because you're targeting people who are connected already. You need to target hard to find groups. We've got some great opportunities out of our challenges as well. We've got an opportunity to look at social procurement. What we're seeing in Victoria is a lot of third-party facility managers being contracted, and council's now starting to realise that there's an opportunity to work with that facility manager to find some really strong social outcomes. So getting to those hard-to-reach groups, finding indigenous communities, girls, people who can't afford to join a gym, and providing programs and opportunities for them. And social procurement, when you're looking at those things in the early stages of contract negotiation, that's the time to be doing it, not after it opens, because that's a surprise to the business operators. The business sector has a role to play. So some of the learning for me out of Christchurch is that we certainly can't afford, and the governments can't afford, to build everything for everybody. And when you think about how much the private sector operates in our industry, there's a great opportunity to incentivise the private sector to come in and maybe run some squash courts, indoor rock climbing, maybe some learn to swim schools in areas that we just don't think we can afford to build full-on aquatic centres. So we need to embrace the private sector and work with them on filling in the gaps that we don't want to fill. Co-location, hubs, shared facilities, multi-use, it's an obvious thing. We're doing some great things in Victoria, mainly instigated by local councils, because they've come to the reality that they can't afford to build separate pools, libraries, council offices, art galleries. And they're working on putting all these facilities in one location and seeing how they can share those spaces. Opportunity again to work with schools closely, work with the education department. It's going to take a top-down approach rather than a bottom-up approach. I don't think bureaucracy is going to fix it, but we need to keep selling the message that we can get more kids participating for a little bit of extra, a little bit more space. Universal design and sustainable design as well are important opportunities to take advantage of. So universal design, in case you don't know, and we're about to release a lot of information on this, is designing facilities. So it's a design philosophy. It's not compliance. It goes beyond compliance. And it looks at designing facilities that cater for the broadest possible market. So there are seven principles that guide universal design. Things like creating flexible spaces, equitable spaces, making sure that mums with prams, people with wheelchairs, and able-bodied people can use the same entrance, not separating. So without picking on the design of this facility, I noticed when we got out of the taxi this morning that there is a set of stairs right at the front and the ramp is all the way to the side of the building. And so if I'm with somebody in a wheelchair, I've got to make a choice whether I treat them with respect and go with them down the ramp, of which we've got to go all the way around the side, or I go up the stairs and he's separated because that person's in a wheelchair. And that might not mean a lot to us able-bodied people, but for someone in a wheelchair who is constantly discriminated against, whether it be by the built infrastructure or services, it's another kick in the guts. You're not worthy to come through the front door, you've got to go around the side. So universal design seeks to treat people with respect. The beauty of universal design as well is by improving accessibility to facilities, you can improve your business. And improving your business means higher revenues. And when you couple that with ESD features, which means reducing the building cost, we think there are two great reasons why facilities should become more sustainable. So these are the two key planks the Victorian government's working on over now and the next few years to ensure that we can work with local government to do these two things. And then when you add the programming and the broader facility design to that, you've got a really powerful facility. Some examples of poor provision. Apologies if you can't see those photos very clearly. This is a very poor example of how you don't provide kitchen or secondary spend opportunities. So the capacity of this kitchen, the cleanliness and the safety of this kitchen is not up to scratch. And this limits the club's ability to provide high quality, healthy food to club members and supporters that go there and reduces their ability to produce income. An obvious safety issue. This is in a major facility in Sydney, right in the heart of Sydney. To you and I sitting here, this is an obvious safety problem. How an architect or how a project control group didn't pick this up early enough is frightening. But these mistakes still happen. Safety issues. So we've got a lot of old cricket nets on football grounds, and what we're doing is paying to move them off football grounds because of the safety issue. And by doing that, we provide a higher quality facility for footballers, particularly boundary umpires in this case, running along the line, but also cricketers. And it's for a very minor investment, we can get great safety outcomes. Very strong football club, Australian Rules Football Club, and in fact, this is their lighting provision. So what do you get? You get a very worn out piece of grass right in front of the pavilion. And this is in a council with a lot of money. So we need to support these outcomes and make communities aware that this is not a great situation. Again, access. A path that goes to the left, to the right, that misses the ramp. And universal design or implementing universal design will seek to resolve this issue as well. By the time someone in a wheelchair or a pram got up to the top of there, they'll be lying down taking a rest, let me tell you. And again, the importance of this facility is critical. This is a facility in country Victoria that hosts significant championships. And they are limiting their business by having a facility where access is ramped the way it is. Fittings and fixtures and the quality and the equipment you provide is really important to keeping customers. A very boring water space. So part of our seasonal pools funding seeks to address the lack of opportunity and excitement for children in these sort of spaces. So some positive news, some of the great things that are happening and some of the things maybe you can take back to your environments. Multi-use synthetics, particularly in primary schools, are working really well if we can get over the capital replacement issue. Synthetics for sports, of course, are working well. Here's an example in a growth area in Melbourne where we have an oval, a cricket and Australian rules oval with a cricket wicket in the middle, a soccer pitch, a running track, and the whole thing is synthetic and it's lit. It's a brilliant outcome. So the challenge here after you've done all that is to program the thing properly. And in fact, when you start doing the planning, the programming actually dictates what this should look like and how it's used and operated. This is a large primary school, again in a growth area. We've been able to support the development of a change room facility, a pavilion, attached to a basketball stadium that's three courts. And we want to support 2, 3, 4 court facilities rather than just 1 or 3-quarter courts because they are financially viable. Our modelling shows us you can get enough people through those to make enough money to run the business. And so in fact, instead of the school or the council running that building, the YMCA runs it. And they invest any profit they make back into running the programs and getting disadvantaged kids through that building. It's a great outcome. Another example of a school facility that is also upscaled to accommodate theatre and arts performances. We're modernising outdoor pools. So I think in England, there is not so much an emphasis on providing outdoor pools, but in some of our places in Victoria, it's still extremely popular. But having a roof over half the outdoor pool is a great solution for the colder months and for people who are worried about getting burnt, because the sun can burn in Melbourne. Provision of leisure water with shade. This stuff is so popular. It'll be freezing. I visit this facility, in fact, and it'll be freezing that during the day and we get there at 6 o'clock for swimming lessons. It is cold, icy cold, but there are kids out here mucking around on the water. You know, kids don't feel the cold, they don't care. So to have that open after hours is a really great outcome for some of those kids. In fact, if I go back to this pool, I just want to share a quick story with you. When we invested in this pool, it was a seasonal pool. It was 2.5 months of the year and for very limited hours. What we said to the council is that we'll fully fund, or we'll provide our full amount of grant money to this pool, but we would like you to trial opening the pool for 12 months of the year. So they did it because we asked them to. We put in the funding agreement. And 2 years later, they've maintained that operation. And they tell us now that the keen lap swimmers still turn up. Doesn't matter how hot or cold it is, they are still there. But they're also starting to bring other family members to the pool. And there's programming. So we can have scuba diving classes in the pool, which can operate during winter. So a bit of creativity, pushing the boundaries. And we've got a facility that now opens 12 months of the year. This is the same facility again. The water slide was redeveloped on this site and we had a discussion about placemaking with the council. And this is a smaller community and the water slide is in fact the biggest structure in the town. And what we said to them was, when you redevelop this whole facility, why would you have the old bit showing to the public? This is a centre that creates community pride. It has the opportunity to uplift people and point to a new icon in the community. So the council were happy eventually to invest in making the slide a beacon. And this is now in the centre of the town and it lights up at night. So if you think about not just the lighting bit, but what a great marketing opportunity. People that pass through there at night or people that are not in town during the day because they're working or at school see this and they think, I'd love to go and look at that during the day or when I'm free on the weekend. Leisure water is extremely popular, both indoor and outdoor. Indoor facilities. So this is an indoor hockey facility that's been created out of an old agricultural society shed. So they put some cladding around the windows, around the walls, put some vinyl down, put some new lights, replaced the old damaged windows, all for $10,000. Great outcome. This is a bowling club that might be very hard to see. We replaced the floor in the bowling club, which we were skeptical about early, until they told us they had a very strong indoor bowling program. And so in winter, when it's pouring in Melbourne, which it often does, nobody has to go home, they can go inside and have an indoor bowling competition. So we generate the new participation with a very low cost investment. Community spaces that are flexible and able to be hired out. Different forms of sport, popular in the UK of course, we've just introduced a five-a-side facility. The success of that will be based upon the marketing. And I'm not sure just yet that the maturity of our soccer audience is ready to make this a real success. So we need to keep learning lessons from the UK about how they develop that audience. We all want flexibility, we don't want to commit. And having no contracts and being able to go anytime rather than 5 o'clock every morning is a huge winner. So I'm asking myself, when I'm back home, does council need to get into the 24/7 market? Do we leave it to the private sector? Do we have a role to play? Should programs be open at night, like Midnight Madness? How far do we take it? So these are the questions the sector, as it becomes more evolved and mature, needs to ask itself. Junior adventure, you know, introduction to rock climbing at a playground in a very safe, softfall environment. And of course, adult adventure. And we're seeing uptake in events like Tough Mudder, which is where 10,000 people go to Phillip Island and they jump in mud and get electrocuted and jump over barbed wire, all in the name of fun, putting their bodies on the line. And it's another form of individualisation of sport as well and recreation. We're seeing community centres, not sports pavilions. So if you've got growth issues and you've got communities that are growing, don't build separate community and sports facilities, build them as one facility. And then all you need to work out is design, management, operation issues. And if you can build a really successful relationship during the planning stage, this will work really well. Universal design, just to illustrate how that works. These are three separate bodies of water. This facility's recently been redeveloped, a dive pool, 25 metre lap pool and a learn to swim pool. What we did very simply and at low cost, in fact during the rebuild it was at no cost because it was totally part of the project, was from the change rooms on this side of the building, we introduced from the concourse a ramp that was at the right gradient that turned the corner, and you can venture into the shallow end of the 25 metre pool, you can venture into the shallow end of the learn to swim pool, but also if you're going to go and do water aerobics or do some diving or bombing, you can swim around to the diving pool as well. Before that, we had steps to each one of those pools and ramps that took up too much water space. So what we got out of this was better programming opportunities, more customers, less water space taken up with ramps and steps, and a beautiful, good-looking entry to the pool. And that's the benefit of universal design as a very small example. Connectivity, we're very good at building skate parks, but we're very good at building them in isolation. What we need to think about when we're designing these spaces is that we connect them to car parks, to bus stops, to walkways and shopping centres and other thoroughfares. So what we've been able to do is to connect the skate park here to the car park and also have little skating opportunities and seats and bubblers along the way. Convertible spaces, I mentioned the stadium before with the three courts that become one show court. Different experiences, so this is a fitness room during the day and it's a disco during the day. So for all those disco lovers who get up at 2 o'clock, you can still attend gym and have an aerobics class or a fitness class. It just differentiates the offering that we're giving to communities and giving to customers. It's not the same old aerobics offering. As I mentioned before, we're getting rid of cricket nets and putting in a lot of multi-use training facilities. So this is basically a cage. It's a rectangular cage with synthetic grass on the inside. These storage sheds have nets that come across, so you can individualise the cricket nets. You can pull them back and it can be used. This particular example is used for lacrosse, for netball, for cricket and for Australian rules football. So to be able to get that activity off an oval, which damages the grass of course and reduces the life of that surface, get them onto a facility like this, light it at night, and you can have five night a week access and use it on weekends as well if you wanted to. Co-location and hubbing and shared and multi-use, it's all the rage. This is a facility in the outskirts of Melbourne which has a 25 metre pool, a gym, program room, a library, a theatreette, performing arts space, health service and a creche. It's the best example of how you would co-locate all those facilities under one management model. The challenge with this though is you need all of those facilities to be coming to the end of their life to be able to put them somewhere else at the same time. So the stars aligned in this case. I talked about connectivity earlier. To take that a step further, I want to talk to you quickly about placemaking. This is the Peninsula Aquatic Centre that's being built in Frankston, which is one of the largest suburbs on our peninsula, still in the Melbourne metropolitan area. This is a large, again, another $48 million building. And it looks great, you know, it's going to do all the things it needs to do. But we need to think about these things in context. So what you can't see in that slide, you can see here, is that this is the site for the new aquatic centre. What's behind it is a TAFE campus with 15,000 students, the biggest TAFE campus, which is basically trade school in Melbourne. The largest TAFE campus in Victoria. You have a end-of-the-line railway station here. You have significant size shopping mall, you have the beach, you have cafes, shops, a lot of traffic, you have a freeway close by. So when you think about the context that these facilities sit in, you need placemaking to make them work. So how do we connect shoppers who go and do their shopping, who go to Myer, who want to go for a swim afterwards or vice versa? How do we get people from this facility into town to spend some money? How do we get them to the beach? How do we create opportunities for triathletes to use this facility as their swim leg in winter? So all these things need to be discussed, need to be put into the planning stage of these projects. And everything sits in a context. Precincts are really popular as well because the economies of scale, of course. In this site, we can get 8 playing fields and only 2 buildings. Now, they're substantial buildings, but they can service 4 playing fields each at the same time. That's better than building 4 buildings. This is another big precinct as well in the growth areas. Walkability boulevards, you know, stems from the connectivity connection issue. Providing very attractive green spaces that connect you to buildings. And if you look at this one, we've used universal design as an appropriate approach to this facility or this area. And you can see the creation of markings in the concrete to allude people to where the opening of the facility is. So you can reduce the amount of money you spend on signage by creating cues in the natural environment to lead people to a destination. Business partnerships, someone asked about sponsorship before and naming rights. We're happy to have and supportive of naming rights. We have a number of companies support facilities. This is a bank that supports a stadium on school facilities. The only issue we had was that the bank wanted to put an ATM inside the building. And that was a no-no. You just can't have an ATM at a school. It was something that the council and in fact the school were not willing to tolerate. But we got around that issue. We have a lot of recreation programming opportunities. So we do a lot of recreation, you provide a lot of recreation. How do we turn that interest into social events? How do we get people more interested in attending and viewing and being exposed to these things? And how do we give these kids who are wonderful athletes an opportunity to become better athletes and get a pathway? So this young skater here might be in the X Games one day. He might end up in the Winter Olympics. And without these events, he might not be exposed to sort of competition that he needs to be. So it's a great opportunity. Play spaces are of course popular. Adult games are becoming popular. In my local shopping centre, the centre management set up a life-size chess set. and there'll be two people playing, the mostly older gentlemen playing, and there's 30 people standing around watching. Now, I don't know what they'll be doing if they weren't doing that. They might be in their homes, bored, watching TV. What a great social outlet for a very little investment. And looks like a lot of fun too. Quality secondary spend opportunities. Healthy options. You know, every time I go to a pool and I see chips and potato cakes, I just cringe. That's not the message that we want to be giving our kids. That's not lifelong healthy habit to be doing. ESD, solar panels is an obvious one. That's out of the Gold Coast. And that actually operates that building. So that powers that building to run concerts and events at night. Big focus on women and girls in Victoria. So we're doing that by providing women and girls in sport with leadership opportunities, by mentoring them, by getting women into coaching and volunteering, change rooms, making sure that programming is equal. So if we get an application that is for change rooms for boys soccer, we want to make sure when that club applies to us the next time, because we'll knock it back, they are going to provide opportunities for girls and women's soccer. We want equality. And that comes out of universal design as well, the equitable approach. Outdoor group fitness and exercise equipment is really popular right around the world, I would guess. Individualisation of sport. This guy's checking out his own arms. Tools for better facilities. So just some of the things that we do to get the best quality out of our investment. We support project development. So we want to be involved. We have a number of staff right across Victoria that want to be involved in project development. We don't want to get an application and say, what the hell is this all about? Nobody spoke to us. If we focus on developing projects, the good projects will fund themselves. The good applications will fund themselves. So the more advice and support we get early on, the better off we'll be. And getting outcomes out of that process as well is critical. We have a generally broad facility engagement process. So every day, as you would, somebody rings up or writes a letter to the minister saying, you know, we'd love this facility to be built. We have no money. We have no club. We think this should be built. So we would sit down with them and go through this sort of process. We would test what research has been done. We would look at who are the key partners that have been involved and suggest some of the key stakeholders they talk to. We would identify the planning and the feasibility that needs to be done along the way, and we might end up supporting some of that as well. We want to influence that planning. It's not good enough just to give out money. We need to have a seat at the PCG. We need to be on the project steering committee. We need to be inputting and approving the project brief that goes out to market. That's where you get your influence. You don't get your influencing reading the final draft and saying that full stop's in the wrong place. You know, that's the wrong time to be doing it, and that's the wrong message. We have a general hierarchy of planning. So when I talk about planning, I'm talking about all these things. Some national sporting bodies have set the parameters by which they would support, either financially or with letters of support facilities. So we need to take stock of that and listen to that. We're talking about everything from recreational planning, regional planning, recreation planning, municipal health planning, all the way down to concept and schematic and detailed design. And we support all of that planning. And we need to input into that, and you need to input into that planning to make sure that they're picking up on your priorities as an organisation. We want to link sports development more closely with facility development. So again, without picking on this building is now empty. I would struggle to find an excuse as to why this building's empty. Yes, it's work hours, yes, it's during the day, but only 30% of the population works. So what programs are we running here? What programs can we run? Where are the hard-to-find groups? How can we get schools more interested in hiring this space during the day? This is a beautiful facility. The more people we can get through here, the better health outcomes we'll have. One of the tools that we use to decipher whether we make a major investment in a facility is to use an investment logic map. So that determines or helps us determine what the problem is, what our interventions might be, either programmatic or infrastructure, what the benefits might be, and therefore what the change might be. So instead of spending $400,000 or $400 million on a facility, we might only need to spend $100 million because we've identified actually the problem is not the lack of infrastructure. The problem is that the sporting organisations and the clubs don't talk and they haven't developed a market for participation. And this is a really good process to identify that. We make sure that when you receive a plan from an architect, that when that plan changes 50 times, that the financial model and the business model that's been developed changes with the plan. Too often this will change because you're all focused on the design, and then when you get to open the facility, the numbers are wrong. That's likely because you didn't update the financial model during the design phase. So it has to be done constantly. The other thing you want to do, and Charles talks quite strongly about the consumer and the market you're looking at, you need to operationalise this design. So you need to feel you're a consumer, you're a customer, you're parking here, you're walking through the entrance, you're greeting reception, you're going to change rooms. How do I get there? Can I find it? Is the signage going to be appropriate? Is the pool close enough to the change room so that I don't have to walk 300 metres? Is the warm water and hydrotherapy pool close enough to the change rooms and the entrance so that people in wheelchairs who have a sports injury or a back injury don't have to get to the other end of the building? So it's being very sensitive to the consumer needs. And how do we provide a really nice opportunity for secondary spend? So, and each parts of these buildings have a different customer, a different target. The birthday room has a different target market to the kids who want to go on the water slide, different ages. So you've got to think like a consumer and make sure that your recreation planner and the consultants that you're using are considering the different markets for each of the parts of this building. You want to engage the experts. You want to get people in who can provide you with advice that you don't have in your organisations. So this is an example where we engage an ESD expert to tell us about all the opportunities of the facility that we could spend money on, and how much value each of those items might have and what they cost. Because of course you've got to measure the cost versus the outcome. But we didn't know the answer, the council didn't. You've got to buy that expertise where you need it. And then at the end of all that, we test the project readiness. So we make sure that the QS is right, the consultation's right, that their business plan makes sense, they've engaged stakeholders to do the right programming, that the facility be managed appropriately, and that access will be appropriate as well. So all of that is an outcome of the planning and the discussions that you should have had earlier. That's how you build high quality, world class, sustainable facilities. Thank you.